Hello everybody and greetings from Scotland. It's Radu Mardare speaking from the sunny Glasgow. Let me start by thanking the organizer to invite me to give this talk. I'm very sorry that we could not have done this in Paris. I miss you all very much. I miss our conferences, our discussions, so I hope soon all this madness will be over and we'll be able again to meet in our conferences. Today I'm going to tell you about quantitative algebras and the perspective of a metrized theory of algebraic effects. This is a project that I initiated back in 2016 together with Prakash Panangardhan and Gordon Plotkin. And recently Giorgio Bacci joined our efforts and we have written a couple of papers about this subject, and today I'm going to summarize you the main ideas and a couple of examples, hopefully to convince you that this is an interesting field to proceed and study. So the motivation behind this work is the need of studying the foundation of computational theory when one speaks about probabilistic computation and probabilistic programming. With respect to the classic computation, probabilistic computation is bringing new challenges. First of all, because the concept of exact behavior of a program is not so much the important point. So if we are looking, for instance, to the application of probabilistic programming in cyber-physical systems, their probabilistic system is using the probabilistic stochastic information to abstract uncertainty. And for this reason, the exact value of a probability is not so important. A small epsilon difference between two systems is not so relevant. If we are thinking, for instance, to application in deep learning, we are expecting, for instance, to see that, to prove that, that a learning algorithm applied successfully is producing a sequence of convergent models to the target model. This convergence again is requiring some kind of way of thinking about approximation, some kind of way of thinking about topology in the semantics. So for this reason, it appears as important to start base the semantic of probabilistic phenomena not on a congruence-based semantics as we did in the classic case, but rather on a metric-based semantics. So there are many who in the last 10 years or so propose various kind of behavioral metrics to replace the classic concepts of bisimulation, observational equivalences in order to propose a way to evaluate, to compare programs which are not equivalent. So if one replaces the congruence-based semantics with a metric-based semantics, at the logical level of the analysis of programs level, one is expecting to replace the Boolean reasoning with some kind of quantitative reasoning. So this is the motivation that is behind our work. We are trying to realize such a semantic and develop this kind of reasoning. If we speak about computational effects, they were introduced by Moji in the 80s as a way to incorporate into denotational semantic monads. And monads were, in his view, the right way of speaking about computational effects. A decade later, Plotkin and Power and then many others started to look to computational effects from an algebraic perspective, looking to monads as being given by operations and equations. If we take the point of view of category theory, we move from monads to Lovir theories, and equational theories are seen as Lovir theories. However, the classic equational theory and the classic programming paradigms are usually looking to monads in set, and this is not really what we need if we want to provide a metric semantics. Lovir, even before the concept of monad being invented, was speaking about a monad of great interest, which is the monad of the category of probabilistic mappings. And later in the 80s, Giri proposed what we call today the Giri monad, a monad on measure spaces that can also be instantiated over polished spaces, over complete separable metric spaces. However, probabilistic reasoning requires measure theory, but measure theory works best when we are in the presence of metric and especially polished spaces. So if we are looking, for instance, on the work of Panangardhan and his collaborators on the concept of label Markov processes, we see that putting at the center of this concept a polish or an analytic space instead of just a measurable space is appropriate and gives one a nice logical characterization. So there are many arguments for looking rather to polished spaces and definitely to metric spaces rather than just to measurable spaces. However, metric ideas, let me remind you, that were present from the beginning of semantics if we are looking to Jacodi Bakker school and so on. So this is not a new idea. So our challenge here is to develop a metrized theory of computational effects, and the idea is that we should define, generalize the concept of universal algebra so that the algebras are not supported by a set only, but by a metric space, and the metric structure should properly interact with the algebraic structure. So from an equational perspective, if in the classical reasoning we have equations of type S equal T, we want to replace them in what we're going to call quantitative reasoning with equations of type S equal epsilon T for epsilon some positive reals, with the intention of interpreting this as S is within distance epsilon from T, or epsilon is an upper bound of the distance between S and T. So if classic equations are producing an equivalence, that is a congruence with respect to the algebraic structure, so produce a congruence over the terms of the algebra, such quantitative equations are not producing an equivalence, but a metric, a pseudo-metric on terms, so there are terms that can be at distance zero without being identical. And if we quotient them with respect to the distance zero, then we get a metric, a proper metric on terms. So while in the classic case, such a congruence produces always a monad of on sets, starting from quantitative equations, what we're going to get is a monad on the category EMET, which is the category of extended metric spaces. Extended metric spaces are metric spaces that might have points at distance plus infinite of each other. So why we choose this category instead of the category of metric spaces is for various reasons. For first of all, I forgot to say what are the morphies. So the morphies that we consider in EMET are non-expansive maps between metric spaces. So from an algebraic perspective, we should have EMET, because if we cannot derive in a theory an equation between two terms, these two terms must be a distance plus infinite. So we must put a distance between them, and instead of just randomly choosing an upper bound of the space, we can simply choose plus infinite. Then another reason is that with respect to the category of metric spaces, the category of extended metric spaces has a lot of nice properties. It is symmetric monoidal closed, it is locally countably presentable. It is essentially the coproduct completion of the category of metric spaces, so a lot of nice properties that we can use later. So our running example will be the barycentric algebra, which is an algebra introduced by Stone in 49 to speak about probabilistic distribution. So the signature of this algebra is a set of binary operators plus indexed with some number in 0, 1. They satisfy a class of axioms. So to understand these axioms, let's take a look first to one model of this. So if we are starting from a measurable space x sigma, let delta of x sigma be the space of probability distributions over this measurable space. And we can organize now delta as a barycentric algebra by interpreting plus epsilon as the epsilon convex combination of the two distributions. So now if we are looking to the axiom B1, B2, and so on, we see that this interpretation of convex combinations is exactly what these axioms are describing. So the first one says that one zero convex combination of T and T prime is the same thing with T, that an epsilon combination of T with itself is T. This represents the skew commutativity. This is the so-called skew associativity, so expected results. So this is a classic algebra. If we, but on the category of on the set delta, we have some meaningful metrics, such as Kantorovich metric, for instance, or total variation metric, or there are a couple of others. So if we want now to turn this algebra into an algebra that will start to axiomatize such a metric, we will have then to have equations of type equal epsilon between distributions. First of all, our axioms will all replace equality with equal zero, but we will then have to find some axioms that are properly speaking about equal epsilon equations for epsilons which are not only zero. And this is what we're going to do. Now, let's take a deeper look to see what that requires on the meta-theoretical part. So, in the classic equational theory, we have a set of deduction rules. Here I have listed four for you. So the first three, for instance, are encoding the fact that equality is an equivalence. The last one encodes the fact that any function in the signature is a congruence, and so on and so forth. All this will have to be adapted to the quantitative case. So the fact all equal epsilons are reflexive and symmetric, but for instance, equal epsilon are not transitive. Instead, the transitivity will be replaced by a rule that is encoding the triangle inequality. The same about the congruence rule. So if we replace equal in the congruence rule with equal epsilon, what we encode here is the fact that any function in our signature is non-expansive. And so on and so forth, we can have a couple of more deduction rules that will define a quantitative equational theory. What is a quantitative algebra? So a quantitative algebra is a construction of this type where A omega represent a classic omega algebra. AD is a metric space, so the omega algebra is supported not by a set A only, as in the case of universal algebra, but by a metric space where D is an extended metric, so it might have the value plus infinite. And moreover, the algebraic structure properly interacts with the metric in the sense that all functions in omega are non-expansive. What is a morphism of quantitative algebras is just a morphism of omega algebras, which in addition is also a non-expansive map on the supported metric spaces. So now let's denote by QA of omega, the category of omega quantitative algebras. So now if we get a signature omega and a set X of variables, we can construct all the terms within this signature and this set of variables. Let's call this omega hat X. And then we can write down quantitative judgments, which will be sets of hypotheses, sets of quantitative equations proving another quantitative equation. And now if we have a quantitative algebra A, we can speak about when such an algebra satisfies such a judgment. And that will happen when for any assignment alpha of terms to elements in algebra, I have that every time the set of hypotheses is satisfied, so the distance between the interpretation of S, E, and T is smaller or equal epsilon E for all E and I. This implies that the interpretation of S and T is upper bounded by epsilon as well. With this definition, we can easily prove a completeness result. So given a quantitative equational theory U over omega X, let's QA of U denote the set of all models of the theory U. Then we can prove that A judgment gamma proves S equal epsilon t is in U if and only if for all algebras in QA of U, this judgment is satisfied. Next, we can construct a concept of term algebra. So if we start from the signature and a quantitative equational theory U, at the first step, we can construct an omega algebra in the classic way. And then using U, we can define a pseudometric over the terms. So the distance between S and T will be just the infimum of all epsilon such that the equation X equal epsilon T is provable in U. And with this, we can now obtain a quantitative algebra over the omega structure. And not only, but this quantitative algebra is actually a model of U. Very important result. We can also freely generating models. So again, we start with the quantitative equational theory U over omega hat X. And if we have a metric space MD, we will use it as a generator to induce now a metric space over the terms I can construct from M. So first of all, we construct all the terms we can from M and the signature omega, and this omega hat will be now an omega algebra, and then we can use U to define a metric over the terms in omega hat M. So the distance between two such terms will be the infimum of all epsilon, so that I can find an assignment alpha and two terms S and T in omega X, so that M and N are the interpretation of an S and T, and actually S equal epsilon T is provable in U. Exactly as you would expect this to be done. With this in mind, now we can define the freely generated model. I will call it from now on omega U MD, which is not only a quantitative algebra, but is actually a quantitative algebra that satisfies the theory U. So it is the freely generated model. And in fact, this freely generated model has indeed the universal mapping property for the metric space MD to the forgetful functor that is taking any quantitative algebra satisfying U and is forgetting the algebraic structure, so returns the support metric space. the natural transformation here, eta, that is mapping MD in its in the extended metric space, is actually taking any M to itself, any element in M to itself. So with these results, we actually have a nice landscape. Observe that omega U that I just defined is an endo functor that defines a model, a monad on the category of extended metric spaces. So if we are starting with a quantitative equational theory U, on one hand, we can define the monad of the functor omega U, which is a monad on EMET. On the other hand, we can define the category of models of U, and we could prove that the category of models of U is actually isomorphic with the category of omega U Eilenberg-Moore algebras. This is a very interesting result. So now if we go back to the barycentric algebra, I put this slide to remind you what that was. Let's try to turn it into a quantitative algebra. So we take the axioms B1, B2, skew commutativity, skew associativity as before, and I am proposing you now a new axiom. I will call it IB, which is coming from interpolative barycentric. This is how I'm going to call this algebra, interpolative barycentric algebras. So this axiom is reflecting what the geometric fact that I draw for you here. So if the term S1 is a distance epsilon 1 of term T2, S2 is a distance epsilon 2 of term T2, then if I'm taking the R convex combination of S1 and S2, which is S1 plus RS2, and the R convex combination T1 and T2 here, then their distance is the R convex combination of epsilon 1 and epsilon 2. This is what this axiom IB is saying. So let's call I, curly I, this theory that is axiomatized by B1, B2, S, CSA and IB. So this is definitely a metric, and we can interpret it over the distributions as Stone did. So given a metric space MD, let pi of M for now be the finitely supported probability measures on the Borel algebra of MD. And now for two distribution mu and nu in pi of M, let's define plus epsilon as the convex combination as we did it before. We can have various kind of metrics on this. I want to show you for this example the Kantorovich metric induced by D, which is a metric over this distribution with finite support, and it is defined in this way. You can find it in literature. It's a metric with a long history in mathematics. The important thing is that we can prove that the finitely supported probability measures on M, on MD, with this signature, so with the interpretation of plus epsilon as a convex combination, and with Kantorovich distance, is actually a model of the equational theory I just showed you, of equational theory I. And not only, but in fact, this model is isomorphic with the freely generated model from MD, where the map is, I'm associating to each element in M its Dirac distribution here. So this says that in fact the axiomatic system I is indeed an axiomatic system that characterizes Kantorovich distance. This is how I'm reading this this result, because since this model is isomorphic with the freely generated one, and the freely generated one is the model containing the minimum algebraic and metric information that one can derive from that axiomatic system, this means that axiomatic system indeed axiomatizes this metric. So in other words, if we are going back, these four axioms I am claiming that are the axioms of Kantorovich distance, which is our result. There is a problem in this moment, which is that we are looking only to finitely supported probability measures, and I'm going to try to fix this. So I'm aiming to go to the general measures here, and for this reason I need actually to move from arbitrary metric spaces to poly spaces, to complete separable metric spaces. So for this, we introduce first the concept of complete quantitative algebra. So giving a quantitative algebra A its completeness, it's another quantitative algebra in which what we are doing is, firstly, we are completing the metric space. So we are adding as elements all the limits of Cauchy sequences. And then for each such limit, we are lifting the algebraic structure. So for each function in the signature, we are lifting this function to properly go to the limit of Cauchy sequences. And this we will call a completeness of a quantitative algebra. And the result will be a complete quantitative algebra. We also have the concept of continuous judgment. So continuous judgment is a quantitative judgment as before, so that the index of the equality in the conclusion is a continuous function in the indices of the hypothesis. So f is a continuous function in all variables, and these variables are this epsilon I. So if a quantitative algebra satisfies a continuous judgment, so does its completion. This is a very important result. And secondly, if U is an omega quantitative equational theory that can be axiomatized using only continuous judgment, and MD is a metric space, then the completion of the freely generated model is actually isomorphic with the model that we obtain by first completing the metric space, taking the freely generated model and completing it again. So we're going to use this to go to continuous models for our example before. What is important is that by doing this, we are actually going from EMET to the category of complete separable metric spaces, extended metric spaces, which is a proper subcategory of EMET, but a category with a lot of nice properties, as you're gonna see. So let me just show you what is happening with interpolative barycentric algebra on polyspaces. So given a complete separable metric space MD, let pi of m be the finitely supported Borel probability measures on MD as we had in the slide before, and let now delta of m be the general Borel probability measures on MD. On delta of m we have a weak topology. The weak topology is again a topology with a long history in mathematics, and it is a topology that is defined as if I'm taking the limit of a sequence of measures mu I, and that limit is mu, then for all bounded continuous functions from f from m to the reals, the integrals converge. Integral of f on d mu I converges to integral f of d mu. So here the Lebesgue integrals, and this convergence is in reals. So this is the definition of weak topology. And the fact is that if MD is a complete separable metric space, and pi m, which is the finitely supported Borel probability measures on MD, is actually a dense set in delta of m with respect to this weak topology. And moreover, this weak topology is actually metrized by Kantorovich metric, KD. So we're going to explore this fact. So remember that we have proved that the model of probabilities with finite support and Kantorovich metric is actually isomorphic with the freely generated model from the signature B by the equational theory AI. Now, if MD is separable, so is B hat M and DI, but MD being complete doesn't guarantee that this space is complete. So we're going to complete this space, B hat M. And once we do this, we can prove that if MD is a complete and separable metric space, then the model of Borel probability distributions in general with the signature B and Kantorovich metric is actually isomorphic with the completion of the freely generated model in the theory I. In particular, the quantitative algebra of general Borel probability measure is actually the completion of the algebra of distributions with finite support with Kantorovich metric. And this is the way we are using this completion apparatus. And this is happening because all the axioms of I are actually continuous judgments. So this is more or less what I wanted to show. You will find in our papers a lot of other examples of metrics and a lot of other axiomatization, for instance, for total variation distance, for Hausdorff metric, and for many, many others. There are a lot of other results published, and some of them are still under development. So, for instance, we are looking these days on what is happening if we are combining monads. So, the fact that EMET symmetric monoidal closed category allows us to speak about the way of defining disjoint union tensorial products of monads, which correspond to various kind of combination of axiomatic theories, and we combine these results to axiomatize more complex situations. So for instance, we did this to axiomatize the Kantorovich distance on Markov processes. One can look to exception states, quantitative analog of input-output, trace-based semantics. We are working now on Markov decision processes and their behavioral distance, which requires variants of tensorial products. We have also looked into Birkhoff kind of theorems, and we have results that generalize both the varieties and quasi-varieties theorems of Birkhoff for this quantitative case. There is work on multi-sorted algebras that can, for instance, encode the situation in which the category of metric spaces is not supported by non-expansive maps, but maybe by some kind of contractive functors like contractive operators like Lipschitz operators or this kind of stuff. So there are a lot of work. I know that this meeting, so Valeria Vinudeliu will make a presentation about an application of quantitative algebras to treat combination of probabilities and non-determinism. I'm looking forward to see her talk. Well, this is all. Thank you very much for watching, and I hope I will meet you soon at the discussion session. Goodbye.